Hello everyone, welcome to In the Studio. I'm Dennis Sheehan, and hope you're enjoying our demos on YouTube, and if you can subscribe and be a member, we'll keep coming every week with fresh material, fresh demos. I have a little bit of a 11 by 4, what is this size? This is a 12 by 16 we have here. I ran out of linen, so I'm using cotton duck. So there's a lot of things I can't do that I love to do on cotton duck, especially the wipeout method. Just, it's too grainy and it's too absorbent and it doesn't flow correctly. So, what I thought I would do is a little lesson. Just mix up a dark red and green. Transparent oxide red and phthalo green pretty much is what I use. So I'm going to put it in, mix it up with a little of the pale drying oil, Grumbacher. You can see there's green in there and there's reds in there. What I'm after is some dynamics. I'm trying to get beyond what the landscape looks like to the viewer, but I want to get beyond, I want to get the emotional content of landscape. So that has to do, I guess, with a lot of different things. It can be color, contrast, chromas, values, silhouettes, darks against lights, and vice versa. But the immediacy of this technique, this is just all just one basic tone, not thoroughly mixed, because I like to have some of the brown and the green showing on different parts of the brush, actually. So, what am I going to do here? Well, the basic design of all the greatest landscapes ever painted, obviously, is an abstraction. I love abstract painters, by the way, a lot of them, Franz Klein and a few others. If you check out Mondrian, which I've just been, Pierre Mondrian I've been studying, I believe he was a Dutch painter, turn of the century, late 19th, early 20th, I believe, became a modernist, very, very purist, all blocks, squares, very simple. But his original work wasn't that way, and he did a lot of these kind of dark, toneless kind of paintings in his early career, which I really respond to. So, let's eke out some kind of composition here, and based on drips and splotches, we'll see what we can come up with. So I'm going to make some trees out of these things. And we have a horizon going back out there, which is very, very, so it's going to be a bit silhouette-y. And then we're going to have some water, obviously. That's my MO. I got a little spigot of water down the bottom here somewhere. So I'll get a little more oil and kind of brush it, keeping the values just a little lighter as it gets toward the viewer in the foreground. So I'm going to cover over all of it. And the way I'm going to get my little bit of water is to just wipe out something. So there's a good section of white here. Now I can use the shape of a tree to get the water, which is a good way to do it, to get repetition. So this edge here we have coming down in here. And this edge here we could have in here. Now, that instantly unifies the painting. And that's what you really want to do. In unification based on the design repetition. Okay? So let's get a smaller brush and we'll edge that. I'm just going to use this big brush today, 1.5 Benjamin Moore, and one of my Pro Stroke, I guess they call it a filbert or something like that. And nice pointy, can do some nice trees. Put a tree right up in here. Of course, we got a big tree up here. We might fill in some of this. And we want to edge that little bit of water there. So I'm going to put some darks in there, retaining the shapes that I want. And then some of this is going to reflect down here, of course. There. Now if I want to show a little more texture on the grasses, I just take my paper towel and lighten it up a bit. Want some lost and found on the water too. And then get some grassy textures, which will give more interest. And for just using two colors, I sure do have a lot of different tones going on down here in the foreground. And you can do the same in the sky. I'm probably going to just wet this paper towel a little bit with some oil. And I'm going to get a little bit of that color on there. And just with the oil, it's just going to be a neutral tone. So I don't want a white sky, but I do want to tone it down, make it a little more tonalistic. Over this side, we'll get a little deeper. And then in the middle, there'll be some kind of light. But I got to differentiate between the tree shapes and the sky shapes, the light of the sky. We got a lot of green in there, too. That's going to be tricky. Might have to get some thick opaque paint to cover that up. See that? You got an instant Murphy. J.F. Murphy or Bruce Crane or whoever you like. I'm going to dip into some color here just for the sake of that. Trying to get rid of that green I put in there. And then we'll go up here into the sky. Into the tree foliage. We want some tree foliage here. I guess we have an autumn scene. So I don't want to lose that shape that I already had. So what I'm going to do is emphasize it a little stronger with a little color, a little bit, not so much color, but just a neutral gray. Kind of matching the tone of the sky that's already there, which isn't too hard to do with a little brown and brown, blue, yellow, white. Then I'm going to lighten it up, of course. So all these light areas that I left white, I'm going to put a little bit more opaque paint in. Still, we're just playing with the composition here. And up here, not forgetting my balancing act of the repetition. Bring this down a little lower. Not sure I'm going to keep that tree there. It might be off kilter. Might be throwing the whole composition off balance here. I'm going to get some light into here with this neutral gray. Filling in basically just the white of the canvas. I can lighten this side up a little bit more. I don't know if I want this here or not. Looks a little out of place, but what I can do is just add a little more to that. Lighten up the distant horizon. And basically, this is just a blocking, so when this dries, you can do some glazing, opaque paint, rich color, and go in a number of different ways. Now we know the water's a little too light there, so I'm going to dull that down a little bit with my neutral gray tone that I'm using for the sky. I'm just going to shave that down a bit in brightness. Kind of like that. And then we'll put a little bit of water back here, maybe. And we'll get that pro stroke out again. And we'll get a little more of that greenish orangey tone that we left showing with the paper towel textures. I like this little bit of orangey yellow over there, so I'll put some more of that in. Still keeping it as an underpainting. And that's about it, folks. And I can use this brush too, and I can get some atmospheric edges on these trees. Well, there's a little evening landscape. Like I said, when it dries, we're going to beef up the tones behind the trees, the silhouette, strengthen the sunlight, sunset, throw some stronger greens and oranges with a knife in the foreground. Same thing with the knife, we can put thicker paint for foliage on the trees. So thanks for joining me. Got an 12 by 16 evening woodland, and I'll see you next time in the studio. Everyone, welcome back to In the Studio. The last demo I did was a rather short 10-15 minute sketch using just a monochrome brown green and trying to pull out a composition, trying to get abstraction started and get shapes of trees and develop it further. And as it sat here all night, got up this morning and looked at it fresh. And I really don't like it, but what it's doing is triggering some other things going on inside. I'm starting to see maybe where it could go to improve the painting compositionally. And more mood and excitement. So that being said, I use a big brush and a knife, and I'm gonna just try to feel my way through this and come up with something hopefully much more profound. So hang in there, it's an experiment. I could ruin everything, I could improve everything, but that's the artist's life. And if we can't subject ourselves to failure, then we're never going to grow and produce greater works. So don't ever be afraid of failing. Because, as far as I know, I haven't got any phone call messages from the Louvre or the Met or the National Gallery asking for paintings. So, we'll just keep trying to do something that... I'm going to mix up, actually, since I don't even know what I'm doing, I still can probably show you the palette. Here we have all of a sudden I see a peachy color in that particular painting. So I'm mixing up a very dull peach color. We took a little of this orange, a little red. I can't remember what else I grabbed. I think maybe some burnt sienna, possibly. Anyway, it's a dull peach. Maybe I'll lighten it up a little with a little white. I never thoroughly mix it. I want all kinds of different shades and chromas and everything, lights and tones, grays, whatever. So let's just try to come in with some of this. Whoop, didn't want to go that far down. I'm going to come across like right here. Huh? How's that for bold? That's dangerous, folks. Don't try this at home. This is dangerous painting here. We could shatter it like a glass vase, or we could improve it. Get that out of there. Whoops. And there goes my oil dripping everywhere again. I don't know how I'm going to figure this one out. Maybe I'll keep my oil in another jar somewhere else. Oh my goodness. I didn't think I tipped my palette that far over. Good thing I have a nice cloth over here. So, stop dripping. Boy, oh boy. Now I'm making a big mess here. Hang in there, folks. Studio glitches here. Technicalities. I got a paint everywhere. You'd think I was a painter or something. Let's get back to serious business. Okay. So we're going to continue along the lines that I started. And this is not as bright right here as it goes off to the distance. Now if I don't like something I put on, I kind of erase it. I don't know what I'm going to do over here. Maybe I'm just going to get rid of that whole corner. So we'll take a little of that bluish tint and we'll just kind of fade that off into the night sky. Like that. Just some distant trees back there, I guess. And I'll put some over here, too. So it's just a grayish blue tint. Take that brown, put it into that blue. And we're going to bring that across. Because I kind of like the way that meets the ground. And we're going to get rid of these lights in here. For that matter. I'm being much too careful. I wanted to change this boldly. I don't want to have to worry about it. Let's darken this down over here. We'll tie the trees into the sky. There. Now I'm going to take a little bit more of this peach, yellow, orange, red, dull it down with a little, let's try the ultramarine, that'll dull it down. I'm going to take a little, I'm starting to see more deeper reds over here, so I'm going to put some alizarin in that mix with the blue and bring it down even a little more here, like that. Sweet! Sweet! Sometimes you just get lucky. Sometimes the accidents. Picasso said, anytime an accident happens and you like what the effect is, get rid of it. Because it should be painted on purpose, not by accident. But when you feel your way through a painting in a landscape, a lot of things happen by accident. I have drips, I have scrapes, scratches, paint spatter, I have wet, dry, cleaned off, undertones. I get a lot of different effects by accident, actually, which I think some of the old masters in the tonalist schools did too. Sometimes you come in and the next day you see a painting and you take a knife and you go over something. It's almost kind of an accident that you get some effects you never could have got any other way. So, on the one hand, I agree with what he said. On the other hand, my school of work is open to having accidents happen or just adventures in painting that you never know what's going to happen when you put the brush to the canvas. And I really do like that aspect of the way that I work. Because it's an adventure. We want to see what we're going to come up with. It's got to come from within. There's no place outside where this scene exists. So it exists within. But we got to utilize nature take what we see, put it inside our hearts and our souls and emotions, and with our knowledge of fine art and the aspects of what's good for composition and color and chroma and balance and harmony and line and rhythm and tone, and when you get all those factors, and then you have all this stuff inside that you've accumulated over the years of study and vision and looking at nature and subject matter, you just bring it all out. And you come up with something like this. So I'm just going to kind of fade this out up into the sky here. I don't know what I got going here, if I'm going to leave it or not. So we want to keep it fresh, rich, not over-painted. It's not like we're painting a flat wall, so we keep it, I like to keep the paints unmixed. So I think we'll keep that tree there. And we'll just throw in, this is being put in over a semi-dry painting. So I can't, see I have the undertones coming off on the brush, so I gotta keep getting fresh color and placing it over the surface that's still semi-wet, if that's a word, semi-wet. So I'm gonna bring this over here, but I'm gonna tone it down a bit first with those two reds I have here. Take a little of the blue in there and dull it. And then I'm gonna bring that across here. And that's over wet paint, because I just put that paint in too. Like that. As it goes up, we lose it. I think I'm going to have a tree there, maybe. Right in here, we got to fix that too. Well, while I'm there, I'm going to get my thin brush, my Pro Stroke. I'm going to get a dark violet, red, blue, a little black in it maybe, white. I take colors from the whole palette here and put it, you know, I just grab stuff that I've got and put it in a big pile here, and blues and browns. I just don't want it to be too black when I do these tree limbs. So let's come up with this like that, and then maybe I'll put one in. I don't know if I'm going to keep it, but where should I put it? You don't want too much of equal spaces in between all these trees. So let's bring this up here. Let's bring this up here like that. Still leaking. All right, let's try again for that other tree trunk. Brown, blue, which is like a dark violet. If you put a little phthalo into violet, you get a beautiful, beautiful tone. So let's see what we can do out here. Which way should it go? Well, let's just give it a whirl. Let's try that. You don't want any telephone poles. You don't want telephone poles in your painting. If you have one big giant straight telephone pole, then you gotta doctor around it to get that not so prominent. It can be a distraction when you have it so straight and thick. I'm not wearing my glasses, so it's hard to see here, but I'm just going to put in some thin, lose these as they go out into the wet paint. So I'm going to pop a little of that peach color into that creek, that little bit of swale, remembering we had the shape from there to there, sort of kind of still there. Close enough, I guess. So let's take some of that evening peachy sky and pop in a little more. Soften some of the trees, foliage. Yeah, I'll put some of this color around the foliage too. I'm going to lose that as it goes out to the edge. We just diffuse it and put some more stronger red down here as it comes through the wooded section of the paint. We'll get some in here over the green. Actually, it's kind of pretty. Too strong, we just knock it down a little. Let's go back to that little bit of that swale, I call it. Some leftover groundwater after a rain or something. Get that oil off of there. So I have a dull version of that evening sky color, which I'm mixing again because I don't have it right. Alizarin, a little oil. I don't want it too bright, I don't want it too dull. Like that, I want it. It's gotta be just right. Just kind of pat it on there because there's green underneath, it's still wet, which gives me nice shadowy sections of it. I'm going to put some water back here, like that, and a little of that dark, bring it in to the, and tree limbs come down, reflected tree limbs, that is, a little more purple. Blue and red, darker, into the night sky it goes. Let's fix this over here. Whoops. I'm getting too light over there. It's okay. Atmosphere. Let me go back in and correct that little bit of color in there isn't quite right. That's not quite right. Well, I can bring that stuff over a little further, I suppose. As it goes up, we lose it. And one more bright spot on my little swale of some of that pinky color there. So get the peachy pink. Some of that's going to reflect right in here. And I think that's it, folks, at least for today. I'm going to leave this. I'm going to wake up tomorrow and look at it again. Maybe I'll make some changes. Maybe I'll white it out and start a fresh new painting over it. Or I'll just throw it in the closet, let it dry for weeks and weeks and weeks, and if anything stands out after that, I'll readdress it. I might put some bluish tone up here later, cover over that green in the sky. Something that has to go with the peach. All right. Thanks for joining me in the studio. See you next time. That's better. And up here, a little more of this red. Transitional tones. patting it on lightly over the green. So we don't make a big mess. Pop it in. Foliage, lights, darks, not too bright here. All done.